Hello all my aces, I hope that you are having a lovely day. I just want to quickly preface this video by giving a short public service announcement. Now when I was filming at the Museo Storico Aeronautica in Italy, I was very much limited by the equipment that I had, microphones, cameras and so on, and the audio quality of the video, also with the background noise, didn't turn out quite ideal. Now I tried cleaning it up as much as I can, however there are still artifacts in the background. I'm currently looking into getting some more advanced equipment, microphones, cameras and so on, but all that stuff is quite expensive, so it might take some time until I finally have a good setup. I'm still in a learning phase when it comes to these sort of videos, so bear with me for a couple of videos and I'm sure in the future we'll be having clear audio, clear visuals and a lot more professional looking stuff. Anyway, I hope that all of you will enjoy this three-part look at some of the aircraft that can be found in the Italian Aviation Museum. Hello and welcome to the first part of our museum visit to the Museo Storico Aeronautica Militare here at Lake Bracciano in Italy. Now I'm standing in front of the Macchi Castoli 72, or MC-72 in short, and this aircraft stands at the end of a long line of Italian racer designs, seaplane racer designs of the 1920s and 1930s. Now this aircraft itself was conceptualized for the 1931 Schneider Trophy, which was a very highly regarded competition in the aviation industry at the time. Now the MC-72 is essentially the zenith of the seaplane racers until this point in time. The aircraft broke multiple records for being the fastest plane and the fastest seaplane, and in fact its record for fastest seaplane stands until this very day. Now even though this aircraft was designed for the 1931 Schneider Trophy, it was not able to compete. Especially the engine gave the designers more and more troubles every day, and the aircraft wasn't ready until 1933. By this point in time, it had claimed the life of two test pilots. Now the power plant of this aircraft is quite exceptional. It is the Fiat AS6, which is essentially a supercharged V24 engine. Now you can see the engine essentially in the aircraft. You can see the cockpit, and between the cockpit and the propeller is nothing but an engine. Two V12 engines essentially sit row in row, and these produce a maximum output of up to and slightly over 3,000 horsepower. Now, one of the very interesting features of this aircraft is, of course, the propeller. It is a contra-rotating propeller, which overcomes the torque of the engine. This way, the aircraft will stay in a straight line instead of drifting to the left or the right because of the engine torque. And this is, of course, exceptionally handy for a racer plane that wants to get maximum performance in a straight line without having to make a few control inputs of the pilot. Now on the 10th of April 1933, the Italians tried for the first time to beat the existing record. And Francesco Angelo, the chap that you see right there, was responsible of taking this aircraft into the air. And he pushed it up to 682 kilometers an hour. Now in miles an hour, that translates to 423 miles an hour. This is a world record. And the Italians could, if they wanted to, rest on their laurels. However, they are convinced they can take this aircraft above 700 kilometers an hour, and they work tirelessly on trying to get the problems that they still have with this design fixed so they can beat that mythical mark. Now, one of the interesting aspects that you kind of see on this aircraft right here is the cooling system, which also allowed the aircraft to essentially have the performance that it has. You'll notice that when you look at the structure of the aircraft, you don't really see any inlets or big radiator that of course might influence the aerodynamics. In fact, this aircraft uses laminar radiators. These are radiators that are situated around the aircraft, even in the floats and in the float struts, and that will cool the coolant of the engine as the aircraft flies through the sky. Now, if you want to know a little bit more about how those kind of radiators work, check out this video that I made on a German plane that uses a similar kind of cooling system. Now, even though they had all these kind of nifty solutions to the problems that were posed by aerodynamics, they still had 700 kilometers an hour to beat. And they did so in 1944. Francesco Angelo once again took the aircraft up on the 10th of October, and went up to 709 kilometers an hour. That is 440 miles an hour. This record stands to this day for a sea or float plane. Now, the MC-72 held a record for fastest plane on the planet for 5 years, until 1939, when the German plane, the Heinkel 100, which is also the plane that featured similar radiators for this aircraft, broke the record. Now, the Heinkel 100 went 746 kilometers an hour, which is comfortably faster than the Mach-E, but then again, the Mach-E here also has struts and a float attached to it. Two floats, in fact. So you could make an argument that if they perhaps made this aircraft into a normal land-based aircraft, maybe they could have pushed past that barrier, but then again, there would have not been that much room for all these radiators that this engine needed. Now, the record of the Heinkel 100 only held for a couple of months, and then the ME-209, another German design, broke it by flying 756 kilometers an hour. However, the Mach-E, as told, the MC-72 still is the fastest seaplane on the planet. Now, the Italians only tried to break the record once after going 682 kilometers an hour, and that is when they achieved the record of 709 kilometers an hour. After that, they said, basta, we are done, and they never took this aircraft out again. I hope that you enjoyed this look at the MC-72. There really is only one version of this aircraft on the planet, and it is here at the Museo Storico Aeronautica Militare at Lake Bracciano in Italy. So if you're in the area and if you want to see the true pinnacle of what human engineers can do with a seaplane, come to the museum and check it out. Now, I hope that you enjoyed this episode and that you learned something from it. In our next episodes from this museum here, we are going to have a look at some of the aircraft that saw service in World War II. Now, if you enjoy my content, if you want to see more, consider checking out my Patreon. Even a small contribution each month can go a long way of helping me create this kind of content, bring it to your living room, and essentially get the equipment that I need. Now, if you want to see a previous episode of my visit to the Finnish Aviation Museum in Helsinki, click right here. And if you want to learn how the MiG-21, a Soviet aircraft, ended up in the hands of the Finnish during the Cold War, click right here. As always, I hope you guys have a great day, good hunting, and ciao!